Are we alone?
No, I'm here with you.
And, all right.
And
yep. Okay.
I don't, so who the hell knows if we're alone? I would bet against it, but it's a question we don't know the answer to, and we're spending a lot of time trying to find out.
When you answered the question, what did you think of we? Who was we for you?
I presumed you first meant life, and then I assumed at some point you really meant intelligent life.
But wait, at first you thought it was just me and you.
Yeah, well, I mean...
Okay, that was a joke.
Yeah, it was a joke.
Okay, so when let's get rid of the joke, and then so let me ask you again. Are we alone?
What do you mean by we?
What do you mean by we?
Well, I think probably for you and many people, we means intelligent life. There may be lots of microbes in the universe. In fact, I expect there are. But for most people, I think it's a little more exciting if there's intelligent life elsewhere in the universe.
But you expect there to be microbes out there.
Oh, so I would be amazed if the universe was not teeming with life at the microbial level. In fact, I'd be amazed if it wasn't all over our solar system as well.
Okay, so you think we're not alone?
If you mean we being life, yes.
Uh-huh. Okay, and why do you think that?
Because as far as I can see, all the materials that are relevant for the origin of life, from water to organic materials to sunlight, are ubiquitous in the universe. And life evolved on Earth about as early as it could have. And I therefore don't, if we're at all typical, and of course we have a sample of one, so it's hard to say, it's hard for me to imagine that similar conditions elsewhere wouldn't result in similar chemistry, and really life is nothing but chemistry. Now, in our solar system, it's a little easier because one planet can pollute another planet, but that's not really what you meant.
No, English language is something that whose ingredients are maybe all over the universe as well, but we don't expect aliens to speak English, right?
Well, I don't know what you mean by the English language, the ingredients are everywhere in the universe.
Well, when you have the ingredients is one thing, the recipe is another. So the ingredients could be everywhere, but the recipe could be very weird.
Well, it could be rare, but there's a lot of planets and there's a lot of stars, and rare events happen all the time in the universe. But the chemistry doesn't seem to be that rare. I mean, it's organic chemistry, and as far as I can see, it doesn't seem that difficult to produce that kind of recipe, at least if Earth is any sample. So unless we're very strange, and since we're a sample of one, you never know, I would suspect that life is kind of ubiquitous.
So you think there's life all over the universe, we are not alone, presumably because the origin of life in your mind is not that difficult?
No, I think it's chemistry, yeah.
And therefore it's cosmic imperative?
Well, no, therefore if there's similar conditions, physical and chemical conditions elsewhere, wouldn't surprise me if life forms arose. Just like if I have, hot pots everywhere and a lot of eggs, I'd expect omelets.
Okay, now some people, when they ask the question, are we alone, the we refers to humanity.
Yeah, I understand, and therefore, the more interesting version of we is intelligence. Now, whether you equate intelligence and humanity is another issue, but let's, for the sake of argument, let's equate those two things.
But when you do that, you're assuming that we humans are alone on Earth.
No.
No.
I said intelligence. There's certainly animal intelligence of some sort. So
if you're looking for intelligent life, we're not alone. We humans are not alone.
Elsewhere in the universe, you said. You said, are we alone?
In the universe, I said.
Okay. Well, I mean, I think once you've gotten to a mouse, then it's not very far to go to a human.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, so you subscribe to the Planet of the Apes fallacy.
No, I don't. Whatever it is, if it's a fallacy, I don't subscribe to it.
Well, you know the movie Planet of the Apes.
Yes.
All right, so the humans have marginalized themselves through World War I, II, III, or IV, or V.
Yeah, yeah.
And so the idea is that there's an intelligence niche, and if humans ever abandon it, then other species will evolve into it.
From an evolutionary perspective, all the hard work is getting to, you know, eukaryotes, and then beyond that to mammals, let's say mammals. And once you've done mammals, it's not a lot of work to get to more complex mammals. I think the heavy lifting is to get to that point. The hard part for me of evolution, of understanding the origin of life, is getting to that point.
So
after that, the diversity of life takes. So there'll be animals that are strong. There'll be animals that are big, tall. There'll be animals that are small, and there might be animals that are intelligent.
So you think if we kill ourselves, all humans die, what do you think will happen to, what will the next species to inhabit the intelligence niche will be?
I don't know if, I don't know.
Take a guess. You're assuming that that would be the case, though.
No, well, if conditions on life on Earth allowed it, it could happen, but it might happen from an evolutionary perspective that there isn't a selection for intelligence after a certain amount of time on Earth.
But you just said once you have a mouse, you're going to have intelligence.
No, I just said once you have a mouse, it's not hard to imagine getting us. We're a fluke. We may be a fluke, so we may not, so, but we're not a remarkable, we happen to be an evolutionary branch that branched off from a common ancestor with mice, but it's nothing profound about it. It's just now that fluke may not occur again, but if there's nothing profound about intelligence or us. We just happen to be one form of a diverse set of life on Earth. The hard part is getting to the common ancestors.
Well, we're interested in trying to find aliens elsewhere, and they would either that.
Yeah.
Yes, I am. And to do that, you'd either have to have them have a radio telescope or they have to have rocket ships. And that means there's one species on Earth that's able to do that. The question is, how long will it take another species on Earth to get a rocket ship or radio telescopes?
Well, I'm not sure that will happen. But evolution, intelligence is undoubtedly rare.
You mean human-like intelligence?
That can build rocket ships. What, I don't know whether you want to call it human-like intelligence, but that can produce technology and affect its surroundings in that way at an extreme level is rare, but there are 100 billion stars in our galaxy. They all have planets. There are lots of different planets. So rare means that there's still tons of it out there.
So English is rare. There's tons of English-speaking aliens?
I don't know what you mean by English is rare.
Well, you said that technology is rare, and then I said English is rare.
Species that can create intelligence, that can reason, are self-aware, can reason and then build complex structures, are undoubtedly rare. I mean, it took 4 billion years for us to get here on Earth, and I imagine there are many environments that are quiescent for 4 billion years to get you to that stage. But there are billions of stars, and therefore, as I said before, in an old big universe, rare events happen all the time. Now, so do they speak English? Why would it need to be an exact form of English? It could be something and structures were similar.
What I'm trying to do is do a paradigm shift from the usual use of the word intelligent life to human-like intelligence, which is species-specific, which could be as rare as the English language.
Yes, but there could be a language that is very similar grammar and is isomorphic to English.
Have you ever seen an alien?
I live in Phoenix. We collect them and round them up all the time, put them in the desert in string pings.
Uh-huh.
Anyway.
Okay, but not from another planet, presumably?
No, as a rule, I tend to not do that.
Okay, have you ever been abducted by an alien?
Other than my first wife, no.
Okay. Have you ever been visited by aliens in your dreams?
No.
You don't dream about aliens?
No.
You have a favorite alien movie?
No. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Well, what's your favorite alien movie?
The Day the Earth Stood Still.
The Day the Earth Stood Still. That was like...
I saw that when I was a kid, so it had a big effect on me.
Oh.
And scientists played a key role in it, so that was...
That's where the robot says, you better watch out, don't kill yourselves or something.
Yeah, and Michael Rennie and Klaatu, the robot. Klaatu brought in Nikto.
He was scary. I remember seeing that as a kid.
The scientist is the key person in it, and that's what's important for me because it created a role model when I was a kid for what a theoretical.
So the Day the Earth Stood Still.
Yeah, Michael Rennie.
Okay. Given the uncertainties about the meaning of we and the question, are we alone, do you think this question, are we alone, is an important one?
It occupies people's minds, so yeah, absolutely.
Does it occupy your mind?
Yeah, sure, every now and then.
And when it does occupy your mind, where does your mind go?
To the question, to the probability, statistics, and what I know about the distribution of structures in the universe and the distribution of life on Earth. And it's fun and interesting to speculate where it could arise and how likely it might be. I don't stay up late nights worrying about it, but it's an interesting question because it's a fundamental existential question, just like how do we get here and how was the universe created? When you look out at the night sky, there's no one, including Neanderthals, that couldn't have at some point wondered, whether there was something out there other than just the points of light.
Astrobiologists sometimes use the following logic. They say, if we can show that some feature of life on Earth has evolved multiple times independently, then that would become a good candidate for what we should expect elsewhere. What do you think of that logic?
Using the word logic in astrobiology may be an oxymoron, but
all right.
Because I think there's a tremendous amount of speculation in astrobiology. There it has to be, perhaps, but speculating from samples of one is extremely dangerous, and I'm very skeptical about many astrobiological claims about possibilities of life and habitable planets. But having said that, I think it is interesting to look to see if certain evolutionary characteristics arise independently, because that might suggest it's an evolutionary imperative rather than an accident, that evolution will explore that part of phase space all the time. And so it's that aspect is kind of interesting and plausible.
But since all life has a common origin, how can you ever have anything that's independent?
Well, it has a common origin, but the history of what's followed is radically different. You and I have a common origin, but our lives have been incredibly independent.
But for example, the eyeballs are presumably, many people say, oh, they've been evolved independently many times. But if you look back at the origin of all these things that have eyeballs, you see that they have common biochemistry.
Well, I mean, we all share biochemistry, but to argue that eyeballs and ATP are, that, you know, ATP is going to, is somehow biases the world in favor of eyeballs, I think is stretching.
How about a head? All things with eyeballs have heads. Heads are monophyletic, so therefore it has a common origin in having a head. It's not just ATP, it's a head, and it's called rhodopsin, for example, a photosynthesis, a photosensitive pigment.
Go on.
If they're the same photosensitive pigment, that's a lot closer to something important and fundamental for eyeballs.
Yeah. Well, there are correlations, and sometimes correlations imply causality, and sometimes they don't.
Well, they certainly don't imply independence.
Well, if there are enough variables that are involved, things that may, it's the same question about free will. There's no such thing as free will, but there are enough variables in the universe that we live in a universe that's effectively, for all intents and purposes, a universe of the free will. If there are an incredible number of historical dead ends and accidents and other things that result in certain species, you might argue, and that are very different for other species, you might say that they're independent. Of course, there may be something that biases the same in the same direction. And in fact, that's one of the many reasons why I'm skeptical about generalizing on the basis of what we see on Earth.
Okay, now this story of the genesis of Earth, I mean, astrobiologists are talking about the big picture. Do you think this big picture is important for humanity to understand where they came from?
Again, for some people, it doesn't matter at all. For anyone who questions their own place in the cosmos, of course. I mean, there are a lot, and hopefully that the two coincide, that an unexamined life is not worth living. And so certainly Donald Trump is never worried about it, but he doesn't think about anything. But anyone who's thought about anything deeply, the big picture of how life arose on Earth is a fascinating question. Again, it doesn't affect the daily life of going out and getting groceries or such, but in terms of understanding ourselves, which is really what science is all about, it seems to me, at some level.
Do you think you're a better person because you have deeper insight into understanding how we got here and the universe in general?
Better person? No, I'm luckier.
Luckier? But
I'm
you said
lucky that
the unexamined life is not worth living.
That I have the time resources, and I happen to live in a place that accidentally allowed me the time and resources to be able to spend my time on something which is otherwise very unproductive. I'm not producing food, and I'm not going out and cutting wood.
But you didn't say an unexamined life is unlucky. You said an unexamined life is not worth living.
Yeah.
That's a moral statement about how valuable it is to examine your life. Not about luck.
If you have the opportunity to do that, I do agree that. Yeah. I mean, if you're asking me, would I want to be reborn on a place where I'm spending 18 hours a day trying to get fresh water to live? Not so sure.
What's your best guess for the kind of aliens that exist elsewhere in the universe?
I try not to make guesses of that sort, but...
You already did. You said microbial.
Well, I'm single. I mean, elementary. But what having run meetings on the origins of life at my Institute, the Origins Project in ASU, I've got a bias which is fairly strong. which is I think that life probably has very similar chemistry everywhere in the universe. I think that there's a chemical imperative leading in the directions of the, that life has solved certain chemical energetic problems involving, for example, energy production, which I expect is done by ATP. And DNA, I expect, will be very similar.
DNA or RNA?
What?
DNA or RNA?
Well, the base pairs of DNA and the choice of which amino acids. I think that there are chemical reasons why those things are selected and why they work. And I would therefore be surprised to find life forms that are vastly different, like in Star Trek, made of silicon or whatever. Except, well, silicon life forms I can believe in, but they'll all be designed. Like the silicon life forms that will be the dominant life forms here on Earth, and if we survive as a species.
Well, speaking of silicon life forms, Martin Rees and Paul Davies are known for saying, you know, we shouldn't be looking for biological life, we should be looking for robotic life, or silicon life, or computer life, because this biological life stuff only lasts a very short time, and then you evolve into something else that isn't necessarily tied to water and the surface of a planet. Yeah. What do you think of that idea?
I think it's an interesting point. I do think if life survives long enough, it's hard to imagine that machine life doesn't become the dominant form of intelligence on the planet.
So therefore, shouldn't we be looking, why are we looking then on the surface of exoplanets then?
Well, there's two reasons, I think. One is because it's a light, and as you know, if you're drunk, and you, as you undoubtedly are at times, and you lose your keys outside, you look under the lamppost. So one of the simple things is to look for something that's the same as us. And moreover, machine life needs biological life to be created, as far as we can see. And therefore, unless the machine life, as some people suggest when machine life takes over on Earth, they'll tune down the oxygen levels, because oxygen is pretty dangerous. And maybe that's the case, but I find that a little unlikely. So the bottom line is that you need the preconditions for the life that created the machine life, and that those preconditions will be such that you'd probably produce oxygen in the atmosphere.
Okay, now could you close your eyes for a second? And I want to ask your emotional self. I don't want to talk to your rational self. I want your emotional self, all right? Tune into your emotional. What kind of aliens would you like to meet?
Curvaceous, beautiful ones.
So sexy aliens.
No. Can I open my eyes now?
Well, if you still talk with your emotions.
I don't always start from those.
No, you don't.
No, I'd like to meet aliens that obviously can have the answer to a lot of questions I have.
Well, that's kind of a rational, I want to meet God answer.
Well, not that, you know, they know more about physics than me.
Well, it's like God.
No, they just know more about physics than me.
So much God more is, that they God can't talk to you.
God is this entity that has no meaning, so I don't understand what you... God is what you talk about when you stop thinking.
All right, so now, 2 billion years ago, we were amoebas. And
well,
the average...
Speak for yourself,
the average,
Charlie.
No, I'm speaking for all of humanity.
Okay.
So when we do calculations about the average age of Earths in the universe, we get them on average about 2 billion years older than our Earth. Now, if we had an advanced alien who was doing physics for 2 billion more years than you have, you can't talk to amoebas about physics, can you? So I imagine that they couldn't talk to you.
No, I disagree with you. I think they're fun. I think the universe is comprehensible, and that the laws that govern it have a common form in mathematics that I think would be, but I don't think that will be violated. The complexity of it may be much greater, but I don't think, it may take a lot longer to discover those laws, but I think the basic mathematical framework of laws of physics as mathematical laws is probably ubiquitous by intelligent species.
So you think no matter how advanced these other intelligences are, we would still be able to understand
something. Well, I think my own feeling is that they're extremely advanced. We're not going to know about them because they have no interest in knowing about us. There's no reason to answer back. There's nothing to be gained, and in fact, everything to be lost. So I think part of the solution to the Fermi paradox, which I'm sure you're going to get to, is that intelligent life probably looks in once it gets if it gets to the stage of being really intelligent. There's no need to reach out.
So is that your favorite solution to the Fermi paradox then?
I think it's a plausible one. No, I think there are a bunch of solutions, I think. That's certainly one.
What's your favorite?
It's quite possible. I don't know what the favorite.
Give me their top two, three.
And the other one is, of course, the standard argument that intelligent civilizations don't live very long, which certainly seems reasonable based on Earth.
Mm-hmm.
And the other one is that it's similar, but certainly that I don't make this argument that there'd be this imperative to colonize. You know, we'll stay on Earth about as long as it takes until there's nothing left here to use. We're not gonna suddenly say, oh, we can go out in spacecrafts. We're gonna suddenly create civilizations elsewhere. I just don't think there's that imperative. You leave where you are. If you look at the history of life on Earth, you leave where you are whenever where you are becomes intolerable. That takes a lot longer than just saying I have the technical tools to go.
So let me get this straight. You said that your favorite solutions of the Fermi paradox, or solutions, would be civilizations don't live that long. Civilization, when they get advanced, just go fold in on themselves and don't go exploring. And the other one was?
Well, the other one's related. It's just basically if they're very intelligent, they're just they're self-sustaining, and there's no need to colonize.
No need to colonize.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, Yuri Milner gave $100 million for SETI to help provide better sensitivity, et cetera.
Yeah.
What do you think of that?
Well, since it's private money, I think it's fine.
Okay.
I mean, I'm in one of his projects where he gave $100 million to build a little spacecraft to go to the
stars.
And I would not advocate public money for either of those things, but $100 million of private money is great.
Because it's too speculative enterprise?
Well, I mean, I think it's speculative and very unlikely to yield results, but it's still worth asking the questions. And you build interesting technologies, which could be useful for other things, and it helps inspire people.
Okay,
you build the stuff, and then maybe the government can get invested when you've sort of broken the path and suggested that there's really likely to be useful experiments you can make.
So what NASA used to be able to do, they broke the path and then, hey, Enterprise, come on.
Yeah, in terms of near-Earth orbit, it's exactly NASA breaks the path and industry does it the other way around.
Okay, I'm going to give you 1,000 times more money. I'm going to give you $100 billion. How are you going to spend it provided you have the caveat, you have to try to help answer the question, are we alone? How would you spend this $100 billion?
After I spent about $80 billion on myself, I take the $20 million.
What would you do with $80 billion?
I'm sure I could find something.
I bet you couldn't.
I think so.
Go ahead. If you spend it on yourself, what would you start with? Buy a better house?
No, I'm not going to talk that about
you, Mitch, brought it up.
I know I brought it up. But anyway,
Let's be scientific.
I think the most important thing to understand life, whether we're alone, is to understand issues of the origin of life on Earth. So I spend most of the money, a great deal of the money, on trying to understand the fundamental biochemistry and evolutionary biology that led to the origin of life here on Earth. Because at the same time, so I spend half it on that, I guess. The other half I'd spend on new techniques to look out, because the important thing about new techniques is that the discoveries you make are not necessarily the ones you anticipated. So whenever you develop new wonderful technologies, you can discover new things. So anytime you open a new window on the universe, you're surprised. So I'd create those windows not because I expect to find life, but because those tools will probably be useful for learning other things about the universe.
And possibly find aliens.
And possibly find the evidence for life.
Now, do you think we are inside of an alien now?
No.
You don't. Okay. Part of that $100 billion, would you spend on microscopes looking for nano-aliens? Might there be nano-aliens in this room?
No.
Why not?
What?
Why not? You don't think that's a possibility?
I think it's just, if you ask me what's more likely to spend your money on, I told you, it's to try and understand how the kind of life we know of got here. We don't even know that. And unless we know that, we can't make very educated guesses about it.
Well, you only spend half on that, but what's the other half? How about SETI? Would you invest in SETI?
That's what I said, the tools to try and find life. SETI's one of them. The other is very, satellites to look at atmospheres of exoplanets. Mm-hmm. But certainly I'd spend some money on SETI. Again, it's one of the tools, because you develop great technologies for listening and also multiplexing, and they may be useful for other astronomical purposes.
Could the aliens be dark energy?
No.
Why not?
Dark energy is uniform static without any spatial variation. There's no way you get, there's no free energy involved.
No,
free energy is a key part of life.
Okay. How about Boltzmann brains?
Hold on. I'm gonna have to go in a minute.
Okay.
Boltzmann brains?
Yeah.
I think it's not a particularly interesting question.
Okay. What do you think of the multiverse? Do you think that has any implications for aliens? If we do live in a multiverse, does that mean that there are aliens in every universe?
Maybe.
Maybe. You have no idea?
It could be a selection effect, right? I mean, it's like there may be universes with no aliens if the physical quantities don't allow it. But we don't know enough about the type of variation that it could occur, or even what the locus of possibilities are. I don't think it's a really relevant question for asking what the distribution of life is in our universe, to worry about multiverses.
You've said several times in your talks that we are a cosmic accident, and you mentioned that was because of the particular way the Higgs field froze. So obviously you think the Higgs field could have frozen in other ways than it did in our universe. Do you know that for a fact, or is that just, so it could have?
I don't know the Higgs potential, I don't know the fundamental physics of it, but it's a possibility. It was a way also to understand the audience. I'm thinking, in this case, I'm thinking much more relevantly to probably how the symmetry breaking involved in grand unification, where I expect the locus of ground states to be much more, much broader than in the electroweak theory, and then you can imagine really significantly different laws of physics coming from symmetry breaking.
You can imagine that, but is there anything about the physics that requires it to be broken in different ways in other universes?
Not in other universes, but I mean, no, but
let's go back in a time machine and start.
If I take this pen, there's nothing that requires it to fall in different directions, but it will, no matter how many times I try.
If that's the mathematical.
So we have a field that's rolling down a hill. Question is, how many dimensions are the hill?
Mm-hmm.
And if there are more than one, then it'll roll down in different directions, depending upon complicated initial conditions and accidents.
So you think if we got in a time machine, go back to the very earliest, I don't know, Planck time or something, and then let the universe go forward in time, that there is enough variety in our mathematical description of the universe now that it would allow it to freeze in other directions, and therefore we'd have different values of C and G, or?
Not necessarily C and G, but we might have different forces.
Different laws?
Well, the laws of, if you mean the law of electromagnetism is the law. Electromagnetism might be short range, in which case we'd be having a very short conversation right now.
That's true. Okay. So are we alone in the universe?
The answer is we'll find out.
We'll find out. Are you sure we'll find out? What makes you so confident that we'll find out?
If we keep trying, we certainly won't know until we keep trying, unless we keep trying to find out.
Well, I've written an article saying we've already found aliens. All you have to do is increase the definition of life to include far from equilibrium dissipative systems. Not many people are bought the argument, though.
Yeah, well, you can always make a definition that makes that. Let's say I accept your argument. I mean, great. What does that tell you?
Tells you that we've already found aliens.
Well, fine, but no one's interested in it. I mean, not the aliens that, it may be true. I don't know the details, but it may be true. But really, the question people are interested in is, are there independent life forms that evolved independently in other places that are intelligent?
Are like us. So we're looking for ourselves. And if we find ourselves, we're interested. If we don't find ourselves, we're not. Is that what you just said?
No, that are intelligent. And the question is, what do we mean by intelligence? That's a long, complicated thing. But I think those are the questions that we can communicate with.
Students, what you've taught students about astrobiology and Are We Alone, what do you think their biggest misconceptions about this question are?
I don't think students realize. Well, I don't teach it a lot, but I think the main problem is that people don't realize how big the universe is, and how hard it is to find things in it. And I think that the conception, the realization of really how difficult it is to seek out the universe beyond our solar system, because of the vast distances, is something people don't appreciate.